that went to Toronto. She had a nice house here on
Lincoln.
Okay.
I believe Steve said he sent him that link and everything. As long as he's got it, he should be good.
And one of the first houses where the name of the high school was the name of the city.
Scottsdale, Paradise Valley.
No, the name of your high school.
I teach at Paradise Valley High School.
You just what?
I teach at Paradise Valley High School. Yeah.
I climbed, you ever climbed Camelback Mountain?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, all the way up and back?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's a big one, it's a hard one.
Oh,
it's
yeah.
Funny when people come from out of town and they try to hike it.
Yeah.
Like, are you sure? No, it's pretty hard.
I was in good shape.
Yeah.
Because I was, you know, athletics and all the time.
Yeah.
And we took trips up in the mountain. I met a gal out there who was a business education teacher. And I flew out in before Thanksgiving, and I'd stay all winter, and I did substitute teaching.
And then I know when you stop streaming or seeing your video clip of what it is. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
She did close it and put the light in.
Whenever we visited my grandpa, if the Steelers or the Pirates weren't playing, there was a Western on TV. I would look at the black and white images and ask him, "Have you seen this one?" He would answer, "Oh, probably." And then he'd watch the screen for a few seconds, and some cowpoke would fall off a horse or get shot with an arrow, and Grandpa would say, "Oh yeah, I know this one." I never asked him if he had seen my favorite Western, a 1962 film called The Man Who Shot Liberty Valance. But I'm sure he must have. It starred John Wayne as an old rancher, and Jimmy Stewart as his friend, a U.S. senator who tells a journalist that 25 years ago, he took credit for a heroic deed actually performed by the John Wayne character. But at the end of the film, the newspaper's editor burns the story rather than publishing it. "When the legend becomes fact," he says, "print the legend." I wish I had asked my grandpa about this movie, because the peculiar thing about it is that for as much as he loved westerns, I don't think the final message of this great western applied very much to my grandpa. Because whenever you investigate one of the legends that surrounded him, the legends always turned out to be true. He really was an influential wrestler and mentor to future wrestlers. When my brother backpacked through Europe, the old German breweries were right where Grandpa said they were, when he was stationed there 70 years earlier. Here's a legend someone told me when I was a kid about my grandpa. One day, Grandma and Grandpa were driving somewhere, and Grandpa asked Grandma to pull over to the side of the road. She did, and he proceeded to get out of the car. She asked where he was going, and he said, "I'm going to smoke my last pack of cigarettes. Ever." And then he did. I don't know when this story took place. Sometime in the 70s or 80s, I guess. Someone at this memorial may even know the answer. This has always been one of my favorite stories about him. Not only because the decision to stop smoking likely contributed to his living such a long life, but because it showed the kind of person he was, a man willing to change an almost lifelong habit that he must have realized wasn't good for him, without any fuss, without any ego, and with total dedication. Because if quitting cigarettes was a struggle for him, he never showed it. As legend has it, for the next 40 or 50 years, he never smoked again. In fact, I asked him about this story once, whether it really happened. And in his short, soft-spoken way, Grandpa said, "Yep." And that was it. He didn't seem proud, exactly. He seemed self-assured, confident that he never would have, or never could have, done it any other way. There has never been any need to exaggerate the truth about my grandpa. No need to choose between the history or the legend. His history and his legend have always been the same.
I'm Pastor Julia Fraser, the Director of Spiritual Services at St. Paul's, where Sam resided for the past 4.5 years, first in the Heritage with Elaine and later at the Villas. I greet you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and welcome you to his funeral service today, whether you're gathering here in person at the funeral home or virtually. We're glad to be together on this occasion. We come today to give thanks for the life of one who was a son, a brother, and a husband, a father, grandfather, an uncle, an athlete, coach, mentor, an advocate, a church member, neighbor, and friend to many. As we remember Sam in all these ways and more, let us seek holy comfort in our grief and prepare to commend him to God's eternal safekeeping. Let us pray. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails and life itself comes to a close, you are still God. We pray to you for one another in our own need and for all anywhere who also mourn this day. To those who are weak, give strength. To those who are sorrowful, give comfort. To those who doubt, give faith. To those who are unsettled, give peace. Keep true in us the fellowship we have with one another, and grant us now your holy presence and consolation. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Hear God's word of comfort as it comes to us from the scriptures. First, from the third chapter of the Old Testament book of Ecclesiastes. There we read, "For everything there is a season and a time for every purpose under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to cast away, a time to rend and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace." Here ends the lesson. The second lesson comes from the Gospel according to St. John, the third chapter. And I chose John 3:16 to be read today because it was the focus of our worship service at the Villas with Sam present and accounted for on Sunday, March 10th. I wouldn't have guessed at the time that this would be his last worship service ever, but I've thought since about what a welcoming and inclusive and hopeful and possibly fortuitous message it was for Sam to hear on that occasion. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Amen. I think there are some family members that are also going to share further readings and reflections, and I invite them forward now.
He is gone, a poem by David Harkins. You can shed tears that he is gone, or you can smile because he has lived. You can close your eyes and pray that he will come back, or you can open your eyes and see all that he has left. Your heart can be empty because you can't see him, or you can be full of the love that you shared. You can turn your back on tomorrow and live yesterday, or you can be happy for tomorrow because of yesterday. You can remember him and only that he is gone, or you can cherish his memory and let it live on. You can cry and close your mind, be empty and turn your back, or you can do what he would want, smile, open your eyes, love, and go on. This past summer, I went to Bamberg, Germany, where my grandfather served for a few years during the Korean War. Some of the restaurants and breweries, like you hear my brother say, they've been open since the 1500s, so it gave me an immense amount of joy to sit there and think about how my grandfather might have sat in the same booth as I did, perhaps eating the same bratwurst, the same sour, well, not the same bratwurst, but similar bratwurst, some sauerkraut, drinking a raft beer, smoked beer, the signature beer from Bamberg. And when I walked past empty green spaces, I couldn't help thinking about how I might have played baseball in those fields on an evening off from work. My grandpa loved watching baseball all throughout my childhood with him. My grandpa also loved gardening and took pride in his work. He was the first person I ever knew in my life to grow vegetables from scratch, and I remember being like, my mind was blown when I saw that. I will think of my grandpa fondly when I'm in my own garden planting fresh vegetables, whenever I see fireflies at night, a staple of pharma, when I'm camping in the wilderness and get the best night's sleep ever. My grandpa called it the pharma air, when I would sleep soundly at pharma. Play beanbag toss as we did for so many nights every summer, and even when I make my annual Thanksgiving turkey, because there were a few summers in there growing up where my grandpa would fry a turkey to the delight of his grandchildren. My grandpa was one of the kindest humans I have ever known, right down to his last days. I know that not everyone has the chance to grow up with their grandparents, so I will cherish my childhood time with him, and I'm so lucky I got to grow up with him in my life. Thank you.
So when I was asked to find if I wanted to read, I obviously wanted to, but I struggled to find a poem that really resonated with me and how it reflected his good heart, his resilience, his wonderful smile at all times, and his hard work. So I landed upon When Gray Trees Fall by Maya Angelou. When gray trees fall, rocks on distant hills shudder. Lions hunker down in tall grasses, and even elephants lumber after safety. When gray trees fall in forests, small things recoil into silence, their senses eroded beyond fear. When great souls die, the air around us becomes light, rare, sterile. We breathe briefly, our eyes briefly see with a hurtful clarity. Our memory suddenly sharpened, examines, gnaws on kind words unsaid, promise walks never taken. Gray souls died and our reality, bound to them, takes leave of us. Our souls, dependent upon nurture, now shrink, wizened. Our minds, formed and informed by their radiance, fall away. We are now so much maddened as reduced to the unutterable ignorance of dark, cold caves. And when gray souls die, after a period peace blooms, slowly and always irregularly. Space is filled with a kind of soothing electric vibration. Our senses, restored, never to be the same, whisper to us, they existed. They existed. We can be and be better, for they existed.
Hi, I have I'm going to be reading the Prayer of St. Francis. I feel like that was something that, it just kind of speaks to me a little bit about my grandfather. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there's injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood and to understand, to be loved and as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. I had a few things I wanted to say. Three things that I could state. most definitely about my grandfather is that he was strong, he was humble, and he was always present. He was an army veteran who taught us grandchildren so many great virtues, really. Sorry. He always looked out for his friends. I know a lot of y'all know that he did everybody's lawns. He loved doing that, though. And they were always so beautiful. Most definitely. And he was always very present with his family. He actually was able to see my wedding this past October, and it was very, very important. It was like one of my top five things that I wanted to happen for my wedding. I know a lot of brides, they care about flowers and you know, their dress and all that other kind of stuff. I mean, those things were okay, but really just knowing that he was able to be there, and just the smile on his face, it was, I'll never forget that. And then another random thing that I will love forever is every time I see pepperoni, I will always remember my grandfather. He was my late night snacker. He used to bring all the good meats when you come to visit us, and that was our little time. I spent a lot of time with him as a child, and my grandmother, and I loved every minute of it. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. The passage I read a moment ago from Ecclesiastes chapter 3 is a beautiful piece of religious poetry, affirming a sense of orderliness in human existence that's there whether we see it or not. Therein, I think, seeking to offer a word of comfort in the midst of the disorderliness we all experience from time to time, to one degree or another, and very deeply so at the death of loved ones. Maybe because such orderliness isn't always apparent to the naked eye, the poem offers a long list of evidence to the contrary, experiences that show counterbalance and symmetry in life that are perhaps more easily observed from a distance than they are when we're right up in the thick of things. Though there's 14 of them in all, way too many. To zero in on one by one, it's true that Sam did know many of these broad spectrum life experiences across his long life of 93 years. Apart from the obvious, a time to be born and a time to die, Sam knew, as his grandchildren already noted, a time for war in the midst of or alongside a time for peace, serving our country in the army during the Korean War and in the reserves upon coming home once that conflict was over. He knew a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing in his role as union president and contract negotiator for his fellow steelworkers in Sheeran. He knew a time to love and a time to keep across his almost 65-year marriage to Elaine, and a time to laugh, a time to gather together, a time to build up in the family life they shared with Bob and Karen and Diane. CM knew, as has already been mentioned, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what was planted, or more accurately, a time to grow down, to mow down grass that had grown too tall. While perched atop his John Deere tractor, a task, I should note, that brought him a tremendous amount of joy in life. He knew a time to be silent and a time to speak. And of the two, the silent part would seem to be the far larger. Sam, historically having been a man of few words, ever measured with them, one who preferred to watch quietly and carefully observe what was going on in the world around him. But it's not true that Sam never talked. He was really friendly to visit with. He spoke up well informed about things that mattered to him. And if we can agree that actions sometimes speak louder than words, well then, Sam was a positive chatterbox. He liked to do things for people, to mow for them in particular, but also to help out more generally and quite generously. Always on the QT in ways that wouldn't call attention to himself. His children remarked with great admiration that with Sam, life was much more about walking the walk than it was talking the talk, though he was able to do both of those quite well. He knew a time to mourn and a time to weep at the deaths of his father and mother and brother before him, as well as during the recent loss of his wife last spring. And each of these deaths, it would seem, prompted Sam to value and to verbalize his love and affection for those remaining all the more. I like the entree given by this lesson from Ecclesiastes to consider the breadth of experiences offered us across a human life and to come to view them perhaps with a greater sense of perspective. But I also really love its iconic opening line, to everything there is a season, and its easy application to Sam's life, which itself was organized around so many of seasons of things he loved to do. Wrestling season, and baseball season, and football season, and camping season, and grilling and gardening season, long before the final season of his life that he spent in our care at St. Paul's. Sam, as shown on the video and noted, was a championship wrestler for Penn High School during his own student days, a wrestling coach in several different settings in adulthood, and an enthusiastic wrestling parent as his son Bob in time got into the sport. He made lifelong friends through each of those experiences and is remembered with fondness and great respect by the young people that he mentored. But it wasn't always wrestling season. Soon after that came to a close in the winter, came the opening day of baseball season in the spring. Sam's mother, I understand, was a diehard Pirates fan, and Sam himself grew up listening to baseball games on the radio long before one was able to watch them on the TV. He was additionally a baseball player himself on the team at his army base in Bamberg, Germany. Sam played quarterback on the Penn High School team during football seasons as a teenager, and was a Steelers fan each fall lifelong, rarely seen at St. Paul's without at least one piece of Pittsburgh team apparel on his person. And then during their children's growing up years, Sam, Elaine, and the rest looked forward each summer to camping season, traveling to Niagara Falls and to Erie, into Campers Hill in Wattsburg, first in tents and then trailers of various sizes. to enjoy lakes and woods and games and friendships with other camping families. As the kids grew older, their camping season shrank and Sam's and Elaine's expanded, eventually morphing into full-time residents at the Pharma campground across almost 15 years of their retirement. I believe the permanent stay there afforded Sam a longer grilling and gardening and mowing season each year, all of which he loved reminiscing about in his conversations with us at St. Paul's. Across all the seasons of Sam's 9 decades and his quite varied life experience, he showed a consistency of character that was valued by all who knew him, by his family, by his friends, by his teammates, by servicemen and fellow veterans, steel workers, youngsters, colleagues in wrestling, campers, Pastor Nace at Zion's Reformed, and the staff members at St. Paul's who adored him. Everywhere Sam went, he was quiet, kind, humble, helpful, and acknowledged as a person of integrity. Just a pretty powerful package, all told. And over 93 years renders a lasting legacy for good. We give thanks today for the life of Sam Gano, grateful for God's watchful care over him through seasons of stability and trial, work and rest, joy and sadness, health and decline in this earthly life and beyond it into the next. I pray today for the blessing of comfort to all of those who are here gathered amidst the disorderliness of loss and bereavement. And I pray also for the ability to meet our own mix of life experiences going forward with the strength of character that Sam showed. Amen. In addition to those reflections from a distance, there are others who would also like to offer memories of Sam from their own personal experience. I invite them to come forward at this time.
Thank you, Pastor Julia. Okay. With help from the words lyrics of John Mellencamp, I wish to begin my remarks and honor my father in the following way. When I was born in a small town, and I can breathe in a small town, gonna die in this small town. Oh, that's probably where they'll bury me. No, I cannot forget from where it is that I come from. I cannot forget the people who love me. Yeah, I can be myself here in this small town, and people let me be just what I want to be. My father loved this small town. There is no other place that he wanted to be but Greenville. He grew up on the west side. He raised his own family there. He went to St. Michael's Elementary School, then Penn High, where he forged many lifelong loyal friendships. He swam, skated, and fished on the Shenango River. He excelled at sports, particularly wrestling, and it was a sport that he participated in a number of ways and promoted for the rest of his life. It taught him discipline, determination, character, and leadership skills. He was a man of few words, but he certainly knew how to walk the walk. He possessed an inner strength and strong moral compass. About 20 years ago, I had the wonderful opportunity to interview my father about his life. I love that we shared the same blood type, and at one time, red hair, a love of baseball and football, the Pirates and Steelers, of course, gardening, taking pride in caring for our yards, dogs, Sirius XM, Willie Nelson's Roadhouse was his favorite, and tinkering, making improvements around the house. He was the original minimalist who wasn't interested in material things except for his golf cart and also his beloved John Deere tractor in his retirement. I had to chuckle when I heard his response to a favorite vacation question. Where? Farma, only 8 miles outside of Greenville. And why not? Because he loved Mercer County. He was content and happy in his own skin and environment. And he was a high school quarterback who said that he had it pretty easy in that position because he just had to hand off the ball to the running backs who then ran it down the field instead of throwing it, promoting his own teammates' talents and happily giving them their limelight. He had dreams of wanting to become a teacher and coach and was accepted and briefly attended Edinburgh State College. But because of life circumstances, there was no money for him to continue. However, this did not deter him, as he still became a teacher and mentor for thousands during his lifetime. He was committed to his community that gave him so much, primarily their support and the close-knittedness, and he wanted his own family to experience that too. And due to that strong, secure foundation, we all did pretty well. How lucky was our family to have such a patriarch? He was a devoted son, brother, husband, father, grandfather, and friend. He loved our mother and honored his wedding vows to her for nearly 65 years until her passing, not quite a year ago now. 2 days before his death, he verbalized out loud, "I'm coming, Elaine." She was waiting for him, as were many others, with open, loving arms on his journey to heaven. I'm absolutely convinced of that. He had an extremely strong work ethic, and did you know that he was also part of a group that put up the Christmas decorations on Main Street in Greenville every year when my siblings and I were growing up? Today is certainly the end of an era for one Gaino generation, but my father's spirit and legacy certainly lives on. I am and will be forever grateful to my father for his love, his never-ending support, and life lessons learned. He was a humble man, but he was a pillar of patience, kindness, social justice, respect, and an advocate always for others. Dad, you are so very loved by your family, friends, work colleagues, and as I've really learned this past week, your community, your small town. Yours, Dad, was a wife, a life very well lived. Thank you.
All of us here today to celebrate my dad's life of 93 years, we're all here to do the same thing. Yet we all see him from different perspectives. Perhaps you knew him as a high school athlete or a youth wrestling coach, or maybe you won the Sam Gaino Award as a budding wrestler. I think we all know him as a number one sports fan, whether it was rooting for the Pirates or the Steelers, or watching the Daytona or the Indy 500. Even after retiring from coaching the young wrestlers, He continued to watch the local talent develop and shine. And believe me, he knew their names. Maybe you knew my dad as a neighbor or a co-worker at Sawhill. Perhaps you saw him as someone who helped you out of a jam. Maybe you saw him as someone who worked hard and loved his wife and family. It could be that you parked in front of our house and carpooled with him to work, listening to the country music hits of the day. You may even have met him at the smokehouse for a beer after work back in the day, knowing that he had to be home by 5 p.m. when supper was put on the table. Perhaps you were camping friends and helped him cook chicken on the spit, or enjoyed playing euchre or beanbag toss or jarts together. Maybe you knew him as Elaine's husband, a woman he loved dearly and was married to for nearly 65 years. I am so happy that they are now in each other's loving embrace in a place where all physical and cognitive pain has been released, and they are free to just be Sam and Elaine. However you knew him, there were common threads that tied all of these versions of my dad together. We came here to celebrate and honor and remember the things that made my dad so special. A life full of faithfulness, honor to country and community, humility, kindness, respect for all, his sense of fairness and social justice. We in the Gaino household grew up learning to respect others, help others, and to just be kind. That's just what we did. This is a testament to both our mother and father, a legacy, if you will. In contrast to our mother Elaine, who loved to talk, our father may have seemed quiet, but he was always watching, thoughtfully observing others. He often took that information and turned it into a plan of action. This usually meant lending a helpful hand when someone needed it. When I would return to Greenville, I would often see tools or other household items in his trunk. There could also be a bag of VHS videos, or in his later years, homemade DVDs of wrestling matches. They were all piles of stuff that he knew others would appreciate or even need. He was just thoughtful in that quiet way. I've been truly blessed to have two parents who loved us all and supported us unconditionally. They valued education and worked hard to give us the tools we needed to be successful in college and in life. They shared in our joys and our sorrows. Both knew the value of saying, "I love you," and they said it. Again, they walked the walk. Living far away had many challenges for us as our parents aged. They wanted to remain in Greenville as they loved this community. We came to rely on relationships they had built over the years. From a person who drove Dad to his radiation and chemo treatments daily for 6 weeks when COVID hit full force in March 2020, to an angel on earth, Rich, who visited my dad at least weekly to give him a nice barber shave and chat about old times. My father-in-law would call St. Paul's to see if my dad was running low on chili and buttermilk. There were people here who helped us care for him in little ways that no one would know about and were so, so important to us. There was Nurse Tom at the Heritage and my dad's dream team, Amber and Karen at the Villas, who adored him. There are so many of you to thank that I can't begin to name you all. You know who you were and are, and please know that your friendship to my parents was valued and deeply appreciated by us. My relationship with my father was uncomplicated. It was just full of pure love. As time passed, my dad became more frail, but he always, always ended our phone calls and our visits by telling us how much he loved us. He never failed to ask about the boys, Mark and Ryan, wanting to hear what they were up to. He'd say, "Tell Kim and the boys I love them. I love yins all." In fact, my father's last whispered spoken words to me were, "I love you." How lucky and grateful I am to have had Sam as my father. There is no doubt that all of us, the children and grandchildren of Sam and Elaine, and all of you, his friends, have been well loved. Thanks.
They wrote it. I sort of just took some notes. So, thanks to all of you that came to honor my dad. He would be. He would be honored. What he wouldn't do is tell everybody that. Oh, sorry. All right, things I've learned from my father. And it's a lot of, we didn't collaborate at all on this, my sisters and I. My dad was, he was a West Sider, and he was proud of it. Blue collar worker. '86 and a half, he was still climbing ladders. Even what I told him not to. Because he didn't want any help. As my sister said, he was extremely proud to live in this county. He was humble and kind. Always interested in seeing how others did and do, and that they did well. Never jealous, because he was comfortable in his own skin. He was so very honored to be in the Mercer County Hall of Fame. But again, not something he would tell people. But it meant a great deal to him. And he always had his placard. That was in 1996. 21 years later, excuse me, Dad was so so proud to be there when I was inducted into the Pennsylvania Wrestling Coaches Hall of Fame. So, here's some phrases. That I got from Dad over the years. Do the right thing, even when no one is watching. Oh. integrity was very important. He'd say, "Don't you lie to me. Absolutely unacceptable. Tell me the truth. And we'll work through it." He also said, "Don't live a champagne lifestyle on a six-pack budget." And he meant it. Dad understood he didn't need or want anything beyond his means. He'd rather do it for his kids. Loyalty. So I was coaching at Biglerville and Deloane Catholic back in the 90s and 2000s, and when I'd have a kid that was going to wrestle at States against a Mercer County kid, I'd call Dad, right? And he wouldn't tell me it. Right? He was very coy. He was a Greenville guy through and through. And we came up here and wrestled, 2010, and I think it bothered him when we beat Greenville. I really did. But he was proud of us. He had a passion for wrestling that he passed on to me. His will, resilience, was incredible. From 86 and a half on, he had bladder cancer, esophageal cancer, COVID twice, a stroke, pacemaker implanted, never complained. Loved his family. So thrilled to see his children, the grandchildren succeed. And as has been mentioned, he just had to see Caitlin and Brandon get married. Got all dressed up in St. Paul's at his best. And we were able to see it. And they were able to see it. Didn't say a lot. We said, "Dad, did you like the wedding?" "Yep." That's just what it was. You didn't get a lot out of him. Ask him one time. I found out my company does security for racetracks, dirt tracks. And all of a sudden, Dad told me he used to drive race cars back in the day. And I said, why'd you get out? And this will be for my sisters. I like this. Too much money. Okay? And that's what he would say when he learned that my son, got a job. He'd say, "Sam, up where?" And I'd come up and he'd say, "Where's Sam?" And I'd say, "Well, he's working." And he goes, it's kind of funny. Thank you to Rich Greeny, Jack Diefendurfer, bringing him his beloved Wendy's chili, buttermilk, and visiting him regularly. After he lost my mother, that was very important. As you guys have heard, there's an award that's named after Dad. And, he never, I don't know, it's a period of time where he quit going. Because I think that his humble way, he just wasn't that important. And my mother's asked me if I would make sure that he got there. And that was special. And who knew, it was about 6 years ago, and I finally was able to come home and take him, and I wrote out a speech. Because I thought that maybe people, it'd been 30 years or 20 years, and awards happen, people forget who. They get an award and they're not really sure who it is. So I did a tribute to Dad. And I know he was uncomfortable. But he got to hear exactly what I wanted him to hear then. I wish I kept that speech, but hell, I cried then, so. Rest in peace, Dad.
They played Mark's tribute earlier. Mm-hmm. It was nice to hear that. Thank you. Let us pray. God of love, we thank you for all with which you have blessed us, even to this day, for the gift of joy and days of health and strength, and for the gift of your abiding presence in days of pain and grief. We praise you for life itself, for home and friends, for mercy and forgiveness, and for the good promises that are ours through faith. Above all, we thank you for Jesus, who knew our troubles, who died our death, who rose for our sake, and who lives to lead us home to you. And as he has taught his followers, let us now join to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Sam. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of all your saints in light. Amen. Let us pray. O God, the generations rise and pass away before you. You are the strength of those who labor, and you are the rest of the blessed dead. We remember today all who have lived in faith, all who have peacefully died, and especially those most dear to us, who now rest in you. Give us in time our portion with those who have trusted in you and have striven to do your holy will. Your name be honor and glory now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless you this day and remain with you always. Amen. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of Karen, Diane, Robert, and Mark, who's joining us via live stream, they do want to thank everyone for, of course, attending today's visitation and services for Sam. In a few moments, we'll be lining up our procession. We'll be escorting Sam to Shenango Valley Cemetery. The pastor will be giving the final blessing, and the Newcastle Honor Guard will be performing military rites. Final burial for Sam will be there in the family lots next to his wife. Immediately following, the family is going to host a get-together at Zion's Reformed United Church. Everyone here is most welcome to attend. At this time, I'd like to ask if we could please start in the back of the room, if you could come forward and pass by Sam one last time and pay your final respects.
Thank you.